you write the complaint in its bare skeleton. But I did more than that. I adduced the proof. I presented the proof. It's right there. How did they face it? By lying. Actually lying. Do United States courts lie? Yes. Promiscuously. Do they cheat? Yes. Prove your allegation. They can't. It's a lie. Contemplated, quote, unquote, you purport. Methinks the Judicial Council went far beyond contemplate, quote, unquote, when they wrote Rule 8, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. They articulated, emblazoned, and mandated. Now, my friend George McDermott attended their latest session 2 weeks ago in Washington, D.C., and he met the Judicial Council. There's too many judges. There's too many lawyers. There's not enough plain citizens who have the common sense that these people lack. However, George McDermott said that in Washington, D.C., the Judicial Council was very, very nice to him and to Dr. Elizabeth Pollack, a polished, erudite, bold fighter for American justice. They even invited Dr. Elizabeth Pollack, a graduate from Georgetown University, with a beautiful record, academic record. They even invited her to lunch. The judges invited her to lunch. What did Glendora say in her preliminary statement about fresh out of school, first job law clerks? A clerk is supposed to be a clerk and just that. A judge is supposed to be a judge and just that. That's what we pay them for. Now, speaking of pay, quote unquote, Glendora wants her $150 back. You did not do the job. In good faith, Glendora paid $150 to get justice. She did not get justice. Norgal took her $150 but did not perform. This is consumer fraud. It's a ripoff. You don't know how hard I worked on that complaint. Weeks and weeks and weeks. Hours and hours. It must have been 60 hours. It was so hard to write that complaint and to capture on paper the evil that these 60 defendants performed against America. And how much money it cost to print and post it, and then to pay $150 to have this guy act like an idiot with an idiot clerk. Insert. Return to Ghostwriter's first paragraph regarding pseudonym. Quote, the court need not linger on this point. The court should never have even mentioned this point. It is a clear revelation that the court, quote unquote, has no meritorious defense for what it has done. This court has no meritorious defense for what it's done. It did not act on the merits. This Norgal paper is not legal size print. Not only is its content illegal, but the print is illegal also. Now we got to read some more of this that takes a microscope. Imagine that. On June 14, 2004, that's Flag Day. Flag, you see a few flags around here? The court set the matter for an initial status hearing on June the 29th, 2004, at 9:30 a.m. on June the 28th, 2004, a day prior to the scheduled status hearing, plaintiff initiated an ex parte communication with the court by leaving a message on court's voicemail system. What's that add up to? Indicating that she would not appear for the status the following day and objected to a default being entered, any order being entered that would dispose of her case. Well, that's not even plain English, but that's what she said, his clerk. Well, Glendora says, A, the one-day notice did not prejudice anybody. B, nor did it violate any rule. C, this is misrepresentation. Title 18 U.S. Code, Section 1001, again, the criminal code. It deliberately leaves out Glendora's quote for just cause shown. What was my just cause? No money. Who's got money to spend on an airplane and taxis to go to Chicago? From New York to Chicago. Prima facie. And the reason she has no money is that it's been wasted for years on courts like Norgal. That's where the money went. All in a sham. All in consumer fraud. They told us, if anything happens to you wrong and your rights are violated, you go to court and you'll get justice. That's a big lie. That's a big consumer fraud. So I went to court, I went to court, I went to court, I went to court. I did not get justice, I did not get justice, I did not get justice, I did not get justice. And it's all because the courts are like Norgals. N-O-R-G-L-E, Norgal. Nor does it include Glendora's request for a conference by telephone. Now, if this judge should realize that this woman does not have enough money to travel from New York to Chicago, then we'll have a conference by telephone. But not Norgal. He wants to do every slithering thing he can to dismiss this case. Tells the truth about him. E, if Glendora's announcement, no money, no travel, is considered late, it is because the court did not get its notice to her on time. Courts misrepresent, and that's in violation of Rule 11, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. Sanctions. The clerk should be sanctioned and the judge should be sanctioned for misrepresenting. One door said nothing about default. The last 17 words of the instant paragraph constitute a lie. I sent a motion for default judgment that was in the court before this conference. This court entirely ignored it. That's another criminal code, Title 18, Section 1001, another misrepresentation. This court entirely ignored Glendora's motion for default judgment. Now, on June 29, 2004, at 9:30 a.m., the status hearing was held. Plaintiff failed to appear. See how they change and spin everything around? Plaintiff was unable to appear, is the truth. But how do they do it? They have to lie. Four, the reason stated in open court, the court dismissed plaintiff's complaint. Now, I don't think you can dismiss something like that unless the plaintiff is there. I think that's illegal. To reiterate first, plaintiff's complaint was not in compliance with Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 8, A and E, and I've already expatiated on that. Rule 8 is a notice complaint, and it was. So this is another lie. How many lies have they told? Is it 12? Second, plaintiff's attempt to allege some type of fraud failed to plead it with particularity. Well, that's another lie. I presented all of the papers of these people I sued and showed exactly what laws they broke and what rights they violated. 13th lie. Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 9. Plaintiff's complaint failed to give the defendants fair notice of what the plaintiff's claim is and the grounds upon which it rests. That's another lie. All you have to do is read the complaint, and it's all right there. What the defendants did wrong, what laws they broke, and the proof of their breaking the laws in their own hand. The complaint failed to contain even the bare minimum facts necessary to put the defendants on notice of the claim so that they can file an answer. And this is another lie. What are we up to now? 15 lies that this judge, Charles R. Norgal Sr., has told. We're up to 15 lies by a United States District Judge with his cover-up of the violations that his buddies have committed in broad daylight. This is not a case where the plaintiff has been tripped up by mere technicalities. Well, these are all technicalities, but Glendora's not tripped up by them. Not one bit. But rather, the plaintiff has omitted the gravamen of his complaint. Out and out, bold-faced lie. Now, I read the complaint to you on the television when it was filed. I believe it was filed on June the 11th. This paragraph adds 8 more lies to the count, equals 19 total. Okay, it's 19. Plaintiff did not, quote, fail, unquote, to appear. This is Title 144. This is Title 28. Section 144 and Section 354, bias and prejudice against the plaintiff. Plaintiff was financially unable to appear, and this is the fault of the U.S. courts. They drained her of funds. Further point is that they extorted her of her funds. Like Norgal, they did not do their job. For the reason stated in open court, the court dismissed the plaintiff's complaint. This is Neanderthal. Glendora wants her $150 back and read what Glendora said in her preliminary statement. This case has to be litigated by the plaintiffs and the defendants. You are not to act as their defense attorney, and that's what Norgal did. They have to answer. If they don't answer, Glendora gets Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 55, default judgment. You are not to answer for them, Norgal. Prove your case as to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, 8E and 8A and E, 1. This is nothing but a lie. Your next lie is failed to complete it with particularity. The papers by the defendants by their own hand were presented to you, so that this is another lie. Quote, failed their fair notice to defendants is another lie, quote. They had 30 days notice, plus all the days between the time Glendora exposed their lies to them and the 2 months it took her to compose the complaints. Conley versus Gibson is a very case that Glendora cited, was cited in her court. When I won the case against Cablevision, the court cited Conley versus Gibson. They used the same case to dismiss my complaint. And that's what you find in federal judges. Let me go over that again. The Second Circuit used Conley versus Gibson as a reason for not dismissing my complaint. This court uses Conley versus Gibson as a reason to dismiss my complaint. Yes! And there it is. I showed it to you when I first gave you an overview of this paper. It is increasingly obvious. Neither law clerk nor judge did their homework. They did not read the complaint. All this is going on the internet all day and all night, all over the world. Defendants had ample time to answer. This court, quote unquote, is desperate for a defense. Plaintiff has omitted the gravamen of his complaint, quote unquote, is another bald-faced lie in broad daylight, as any reader can see and agonize. This cascade of computer spit-outs embarrasses the United States of America and all over the world. www.achatwithglendora.com is the site. You want a site court, try that one. Glendora wants her $150 back. You are acting as defendant's defense counsel. You, a judge, are acting as a defense counsel. This is illegal. You are rankly and odiously denying Glendora's due process. See Glendora versus Cablevision, page 9 herein. Conley versus Gibson, Branham versus Clark. Okay, can you read that, folks? Is that any way to write an order? Is this any way to write an order? Well, it isn't an order. The whole thing's a hoax. That's the third basis for dismissing plaintiff's complaint. The court stated that it was relying on Local Rule 41.1 and the court's inherent powers. That's dictatorship. That's not America. That's not a republic. And of course, it would be a local rule. And of course, that local rule, like most local rules, is unconstitutional. For want of prosecution, or an order of default may be entered if counsel fails to respond to a call of the case set by, well, I responded. I was unable to return. I showed good cause. Good cause shown. The authority of a court to dismiss sua sponte. A court never has any such authority. We have a constitution. And that constitution sets Fifth Amendment and 14th Amendment. Due process of law. This is not due process of law. For an adult judge to dismiss a case the way he's done this one. Can you believe that anybody could be that rotten in a black robe at a bench, a mahogany expensive bench of a United States District Court? Have you ever seen them? They exude expense. Festoon drapery. Thick carpets with the seal of the United States in them. Mahogany all over the place. And it's all show. They don't deserve any of that. Look at the nutsy stuff they come up with.
I just made 6 sets. Clerk of the Court, appellate term, 9th and 10th, 111 Livingston Street, 19th floor, Brooklyn, New York. CJA, Center for Judicial Accountability. George E. McDermott, Great American Patriot, Washington, D.C. Cablevision Systems Corporation in care of James L. Dolan. I feel sorry for it. And Charles F. Dolan. And then Glenn's copy, which is going to be read to you. And what's the postage on this? I haven't figured out the hours and dollars, but I just got the postage. If it's 90 sheets, call it 100 sheets. That's 100 pages, that's 50 sheets. And 5 sheets per ounce, and that makes 10 ounces. And so there's an 83-cent stamp and an 83-cent stamp. And an 83-cent stamp. And a 23-cent stamp right there. Isn't that funny the way that green doesn't want to... It blurs. So that's a 10 ounces. What is it? It's 372. So we didn't save anything by not using a flat rate priority meal. So what's left to do? Seal them, put the stamps on, add up the hours and dollars, and find out what opus it is. See, the opus is over here. What you gonna say it is, folks? It's opus 1181. And it's the 5th out of 7 huge legal papers that had to be done this week. Monday was Kleinbaum, Tuesday was Chicago, Rule 60B motion, Norgel. Wednesday was Dolan Harrison, wasn't it? Yep. And Thursday was the George E. Dixon brief, appellant's brief. And Friday is informa pauperis, the appellate term. I'll read it to you. You know what, Van Allen? You know what happened there, folks? I went in because the car was overheating. And I left with the same problem and no solution, but $206 short. Now, I don't think that's right. Something's very, very wrong there. But I gave her my word, and I have a soul, and I know it's worth more than $206. So I gave her the $206, yet I left with the same problem that I went in with. That's Van Allen on Route 9H in Valencia. Jane and John Dean, my neighbors, have been going to George Graham years and years and years and years. So at Vacation Bible School this morning, Jane says, "Glendora, I think you'd better call George Graham." So I did it, and I talked to him, and I liked what he said. He has 3 Lincolns. So I said, we'll bring it over at noon. So we went up and we paid Allen, Van Allen, $206 for accomplishing nothing. And you know what I thought on the way over? I put half a gallon, I filled up the bucket there for the radiator. It's a funny thing on a Lincoln, the radiator's in the front of the car, but the bucket to fill it is on the side of the car. I don't know what's going on. And so I filled up the bucket. And that car just ran perfectly. Even the noise wasn't there. And it ran perfectly about 4 miles over to George Graham. And I was thinking, forget all this car repair. Take your car home. Carry 3 or 4 gallons of water in the trunk and just drive it. And every 25 miles or so, put in the water. And limit your traveling to 25 miles. And be gone, all of these garages and all of the rip-off prices and all of the inaccuracies and the failures to diagnose correctly. Just be gone. Let your heavy traveling be over. And just use the car for the errands, 25 miles or so every week. That's went through my mind. I said, no. Jane Dean was nice enough to set this up for you. And George Graham is expecting you. And you have to keep your word. So I went through with it. If he had told me over the phone that he didn't know he could get to it today, he told me that after I got there. He says, I may not get to it today. It may not be until Monday. If he told me that over the phone, I would have taken it home. Okay, I missed that car so. You know, that was Frankie's car. And I just miss it so. It used to be food, clothing, and a home, remember? Those were the three essentials of life. Now it's food, clothing, a home, and a car. Folks, I just went to my neighbor's house, and I rang the doorbell, and a creature came to the door, and it was something I didn't recognize. It had a blue flower here. And it had a blue flower here, and it had a butterfly here, and vivid colors, and a band here. Well, there was my neighbor Mary, and she had good-naturedly let her 10-year-old daughter Elizabeth decorate her face. So I suggested that she decorate my face. That would be a public service. Okay, we're going to read you this massive paper of 90 pages. And this is the fifth law suit paper that's gone out this week. Monday was Kleinbaum, Tuesday was Norgel in the Chicago United States District Court. Wednesday was Dolan, Harrison, and how many? That was 90 pages, wasn't it? And Thursday was the Dixon Village of Chatham appellant's brief. And today is this one, the informer papyrus in the Glendora versus Charles F. Dolan and Cablevision in the Rye City Court. They won't come up with the $1,300 to pay for the minutes for the 6-hour trial. So I'm asking the Court of Appeals to pay for it. You know, I don't know about that shadow. Can you read it? Appellate term of the Supreme Court, 9th and 10th Judicial Districts, Glendora Plaintiff Appellant versus Charles F. Dolan and Cablevision Systems Corporation, Defendants Appellees. Notice a motion for leave to appeal as a poor person. That's how the New York State puts it. The feds are a little more sophisticated. They call it informer papyrus. And the number in the Rye City Court is Small Claims 02. That's the year 02, 2002. A small claims action is now into its
third year. Number 146, Peter Lane, was the judge in the small claims court in Rye. Please take notice that upon the annexed affidavit of Glendora, dated the blank day of July, I forgot to fill that in, but it's today, 2004, the plaintiff will move this court on a term thereof to be held at the courthouse of the appellate term of the Supreme Court, 9th and 10th Judicial Districts at 111 Livingston Street, 19th floor, Brooklyn, New York, 11201, on the 6th day of August, 2004, at 10 o'clock in the forenoon of that day, or as soon thereafter as can be heard, for an order granting poor persons relief, including free transcripts, and assignment of counsel. Well, I crossed out assignment of counsel. There's no such thing as a good lawyer. Now you remember that. And it's yours, Glendora. A chat with Glendora on 44 TV stations equals 440 municipalities. And on the internet, 24 hours, 7 days a week, www.achatwithglendora.com. And box 124, Ghent, New York, 120-75-914-949-99-9495. Print your name, your address, including city. I don't live in a city, I'm happy to say. So I cross that out and put municipality, state and zip code, telephone number, to the name of the opponent. I got to send a copy to the county attorney. What county, though? Not this county. Westchester County. Yeah, Winchester County. Okay. Before I go to the post office, grab an envelope, grab a pen, put the postage on it, and send it to him. Oh. And this is, it says a poor person relief affidavit. I crossed out poor person relief and put in former pauperous. It's nothing like Latin to cover up a dirty word. Full name, Glendora. Glendora, whether I'm full or empty. Box 124, Ghent, New York, 12075-914-949-9495. It puts down date of birth, and I didn't put that in. I'm 76 years old. Social Security number, no. Social Security says no because of identity theft. Identity theft has hit three of my friends. Married state, now this is interesting. Check one, single, married, separated, divorced. And they didn't put down widowed. So I made a new thing, and I said widowed. Give the names and ages of all dependents. None. Frankie's up in heaven, looking out for you. State your usual occupation, profession, TV host. Are you or your spouse presently employed? No. State name and address of your employer and your gross monthly salary received. None. State your spouse's occupation or profession. I said deceased. Maybe he's a newspaper reporter up in heaven. You think so? He was a newspaper reporter for 37 years. State the name and address of your spouse's employer and the gross salary received. None. Here comes my ride. I'm going to take Elizabeth out to for a treat. I'll read this to you when we get back. I'm making popcorn for the skunk and the raccoon. They love it. I can't take it out now, it's too hot, and it'll be too hot for them. So just let it cool. Too bad this isn't smell-o-vision, it smells so good. Okay, the appellate term, I'm asking them to pay for the minutes, they're $1,300, so that I can feel the bad work of Peter Lane of the Rye City Court. Video equipment, I don't know how much you could sell this for. A household, I know that's worth zero. And the storage trailer, that's worth zero, and the clothes are worth zero. And it says, Glendora says, I can pay $150 toward the minutes, but she cannot pay $1,300. And Glendora is really not appealing in forma pauperis because she did pay the filing fee of $30.
All right, now here is, how do I get rid of that shadow? Maybe if I come up here. And this is good. See, this tells you office rent, telephone, technical equipment, telephone, print. What's this say? Office supplies. Postage. An office rent. Now look at those figures. This is for January, February, March. Look at that. $210. What was that for? Office rent. Technical equipment was $128. Telephone was only $48. That's because I had that MCI package. It's flat rate. No matter what, you only pay $25 a month. Isn't that great? Office supplies. $59, $126, $62, $98, $56, $34. Now this is what's awful. And I've got to give this up. We've got to reform these judges some other way, folks. This is too expensive. Postage, $229, $375. This is by the month. That would be March, $220. February, $233. January, $171. That's got to stop, okay? So I give him those because Franklin and I kept very good books, or at least he did. I probably got them all wrong, but I try to keep them up. Newspapers, gasoline. Ooh, that's bad. Went up to $92 in June for the month. Car repair is something like $600 so far this year. The electric, that's not much. The landlord's paying that. Donations. Ooh, in January, $395. February, $134, $114, $71 in April, $41 in May, and $81 in June. That's donations receipted. And then donations are unreceipted, which you put in the collection plate. And for June, that was $130. That still isn't tithing, though. Or is it? I'd have to figure that out. So we went to the museum, and we brought back a box of reams. And Mary and Elizabeth saw the museum. And Elizabeth measured it with her feet, and she was pretty good. She came out 43 feet. It's actually 46 feet. Total out business, $1,299. Total out personal, $420. Total out business, $1,719. And so forth. All right, this is to the appellate term, Supreme Court, State of New York, United States of America, and the lower court is the Rye City Court, and Peter Lane is the judge, and this is an affidavit by Glendora in support of her motion that the appellate term pay for the transcript because she does not have $1,000 to do so. Alpha, under penalty of perjury, Glendora asseverates that she is telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help her God, and this appeal has to be granted. This court, the appellate term, reversed Peter Lane in the fall of 2003 and told him to pay Glendora $3,000. On the reversal, remand, Peter Lane ignored entirely the appellate term. That's a pretty strange thing to do, isn't it? Except for ruling, the Rye Court did have jurisdiction over Charles F. Dolan, the billionaire. Charles F. Dolan owns Cablevision, and he owns Madison Square Garden, and the New York Rangers, and the New York Knicks, and Radio City Music Hall, and the Rockettes. He did own Bravo, but he had to sell it because he managed the company so badly. He owns American Movie Classics, I guess, and much, much music. Glendora tried to read your order into the record at the Rye Court on February the 19th,
three times Peter Lane and Cablevision Park Avenue lawyer blocked her. She tried to read it during her opening statement. She tried to read it from the witness stand, and she tried to read it later on in the trial, and every time they blocked her. This is a denial of due process. In the year 2002, Glendora asked for $3,000 in the Rye Court. Peter Lane denied this. Then you, the appellate term, reverse Peter Lane, and the reverse of deny is what? Grant. Peter Lane did not grant Glendora the $3,000, and so Glendora appeals to you to make Peter Lane grant. Peter Lane did rule that the Rye Court did have jurisdiction over Charles F. Doan, but only after the appellate term told him to. He ruled this on the reversal remand, and the date was January 29, 2004. Now on the trial, February 19, 2004, of the reversal and the remand, Peter Lane allowed Dolan Cablevision Park Avenue lawyer Robert M. Callagy to adumbrate, and that's a good word for tonight, it's an umbrella, to adumbrate and obfuscate for 6 hours about non-issues. One of these was jurisdiction, which was res judicata and collateral estoppel. You had already, appellate court, ruled on jurisdiction over Charles F. Dolan, so that, and so had Peter Lane. Why did Peter Lane allow this ambage? Another non-issue was returning the 52 videotapes. You had already ruled that Peter Lane had no jurisdiction to return the 52 tapes, but he did. You said Glendora did not ask for the tapes. And you were right. Dolan kept Glendora's tapes so long the news on them was a year old. If Dolan Cablevision had cablecast Glendora's programs, now please folks, hear me. If Dolan Cablevision had cablecast Glendora's programs as mandated by Congress, Title 47 U.S. Code, Section 521, SEC, and by New York Legislature, 9 New York Code Rules and Regulations, Section 595.4, and New York Public Service Law, Section 229, Article 11, and by municipal law, if he had cablecast those tapes as he should have, he and Cablevision If they had not exercised editorial control and had not limited and prohibited public access, then after the cable cast, the tapes would have been returned to Glendora with the postage that Glendora sent the billionaire, Charles F. Doan, and the problem would never have gone to court. Did you hear me? George McDermott stated that. He came all the way up from Washington, D.C. for that trial. Now, Beta, this was the issue. Of course, Callagy obfuscated for hours. Peter Lane was wrong to let Callagy avoid the issue listed super in paragraphs 12 to 15 that I just read you. Instead, Lane let Callagy go ambage with, is there any contractual relation that Cablevision has to pay your expenses to put on a public access program? No, there isn't, and that's irrelevant. But there is law that Charles Doan, Cablevision, have to pay my expenses for taking my show off with no legal or factual basis and what it cost me to get it back on again. That they have to pay for. Callagy brought a witness, Christine Savarino, whose job it is at Cablevision, is to take the name, address, and telephone number of the local resident signer that Glendora gets for each system, call up that signer, and scare the signer off and tell lies until the signer backs down and runs away and Glendora has to go out and find another one. This is the issue. Dolan does not have to pay for what it costs to get Glendora's program on the TV, but for what it costs to get her show off TV. Now this is free speech shot to the winds. Public access is a public forum. It is both a traditional forum and a designated forum. It's designated by the law I just read you, the Cable Policy Act of 1984, Title 47 U.S. Code, Section 521, et sequitur. It's a traditional public forum because it's been going on for 30 years. Just like people standing up on a park, in a park. Indeed, Congress called public access the electronic soapbox. Gamma. Glendora presented to Lane a detailed, documented list of the money that Dolan's lawbreaking had cost her to spend on postage, on printing, on travel, and on labor. It went way beyond $3,000, but at that time, Lane's monetary jurisdiction was only $3,000, not $5,000, and I was asleep, okay, when the New York legislature upped the monetary jurisdiction of city courts from $3,000 to $5,000. And I should have made a motion to change my down then to $5,000. And Peter Lane should have let me know that. Because I'm pro se, okay? He should not have taken advantage of me. He should have let me know that it had gone up to $5,000. But in the town courts, it hasn't. In my case against Charles Doan and Cablevision and the hoods that work for him, in the Harrison court, it's still $3,000. In the town courts. Well, when Lane denied my $3,000, it was around 11:30 in the morning. I could not believe that, folks. I could not believe that he did that. And I said to him, what is your statutory authority? Long silence. He had no answer. And he looked at Callagy, their Cablevision's liar for hire, Park Avenue lawyer, hoping Callagy would come up with statutory authority. But he didn't. He couldn't. There isn't any. But Lane let Callagy drone on for another 2.5 hours. Why? Callagy's paid by the hour. Just this trial alone costs much more than $3,000. or Park Avenue lawyer. And this is the $3,000 that you, the appellate term, had already ordered that Glendora was entitled to. Well, the memorandum of law was to be postmarked March the 5th, 2004. Glendora and her friend George McDermott from Washington, D.C. used the Library of Congress. We go out and use the Supreme Court Library of the State of New York. George McDermott uses the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. to do the research. And he sent 300 pages of statutory authority that Glendora was entitled to $3,000. And the screwball lawyer from Park Avenue for Cablevision handed in a letter, not even a grown-up legal paper, like a memorandum of law, nothing like that, handed in a letter. And guess what it said? Oh, we can't find any statutory authority to award Glendora $3,000. I don't think that was the assignment. I think the assignment was to find statutory authority. And now the point here is that Callagy defaulted. The paper was to be postmarked March the 5th. Glendora never heard from Callagy for 15 days. George McDermott says, well, write a note to the court, write a memorandum to the court. I said to George McDermott, no way. I will write a motion for a default judgment that I should be awarded the money by default. Peter Lane, by now, upon information and belief, has heard from the party. When Dolan gets cornered in court, as Glendora has cornered him many times, but three noteworthy ones, de Blasi, whom we scraped off the bench, and Charles Bryant in the federal court. When Dolan gets cornered in the court by Glendora, he gets out his wallet. Billionaire, he gets out his wallet. He doesn't exactly talk to the judge, and the lawyer doesn't exactly talk to the judge. I imagine that the telephones ring and the wheels start to grind, and the party boss hears something like this, you want that big donation in November. We'll remember in November. So I'm saying on information and belief that the party boss got in touch with Peter Lane, dismiss it. And then what's so awful is they have to dismiss it, and they cannot come up with a law or with facts to do so. And then they have to stoop to lying. And what they put out is so pitiful. It just makes you cry that a human being stoops that low. So, by hook or crook, Peter Lane dismissed the case. Glendora wrote a memorandum that Callagy did not show any statutory authority why Glendora should not get the $3,000. And then you only have 30 days, so after a while I appealed it. That means it's going back to the appellate term a second time. They call it the second department? Okay, fine. This is your second appeal on the same case. And the rest of this, this paper's 90 pages long, so I'm just going to tell it to you in a synopsis, but look, I just want you to see it. I include to the appellate term all of motion practice back and forth, trying to get Peter Lane to pay $1,300 for the minutes. Okay. So then I made a motion that Peter Lane pay the $1,300 for the minutes. And I sent him detailed financial information, some of which I showed you tonight. But the way these books are kept is that every day you put an entry in what we call the diary, that would be the week, for the week, and whether it's business or whether it's personal, and for what it is. Is it a donation received? Is it postage? Is it gasoline or whatever? And then at the end of the week, you take all of those figures and then put them in the columns that I showed you. So that you have the postage column, and you have the office rent column, and you have the gasoline column, and then you have the household columns and all that. And then at the end of the year, oh, also at the end of the month, you put those from the month sheet to the year sheet. And at the end of the year, you have the total that was spent for that year. I believe I've shown you those figures because they're very interesting. Haircuts in a lifetime. Since 1937, $800. So Peter Lane said, well, although Glendora gave detailed information on her financial in and out, she did not list her assets. So Glendora wrote a motion to reconsider on the basis that here are the assets. And I listed the cars and the trailer, the storage trailer, and gee, that's all there is, isn't it? Clothes are nothing, household's nothing. Oh, the video equipment, which I don't think you can get anything for, because the technology changes by the night. You can buy a new camera and somebody will come into your house and say, where'd you get that old thing? So I sent that back to Peter Lane. And then he made such an insipid order denying that. I truly felt sorry for him, but he's under the gun. The party has said. So the party doesn't want this appealed again, go back to this appellate term the second time, and it's going. And so when that order came in, after I presented the asset, enough is enough. I appealed it a second time. I filed a notice of appeal, sent $30. And that's what this is. I am asking the appellate term to pay for those minutes. Or waive their mandate to have these minutes. I certainly am not asking the appellate term for free counsel, because there's no such thing as a good lawyer. Okay, honey, I think that's the gist of it. All right? This was Opus legal paper or something. You can't see that there, can you? Can you see that? Opus 1181. It cost $31.71 to print it and post it, and it will serve tonight. And it took 17 hours to write it, to express it, to articulate it, to do the pulling of the papers out of the file and print it. I have to print it myself. And then I have to collate it, and then I have to staple it, and then I have to label it, and then I have to stuff it, and then I have to seal it, and then I have to serve it. That's all. I'm trying to think of a joke that I haven't told you without going into the file and finding one. I'll tell you this one. Harry was talking to God. And Harry said, God, how much is $1 million to you? And God said, $10. And Harry says, well, God, how long is 1 million years to you? God said, a second. Harry said, God, can I borrow $10? And God said, certainly, just a second. Oh, folks, I wanted you to see the popcorn
go to the skunk and the raccoon. I had some beautiful footage of them. Remember? I showed it to you a couple of weeks ago. I got good close-ups of it. Here, looks good.
You want some?
It smells good. In case the skunk is there, you want to open this quite gingerly. You don't want to scare a skunk. Okay, honey. Yep. She's out there. The skunk is out there. She's eating her, let me see if I can get a picture of her for you. She's eating her peanut butter cookies, peanut butter sandwich cookies. Hold still, let's see if we can get a picture. There she is. She just finished her peanut butter cookies. Oh, there's two skunks. Aren't they pretty? Their little white hats. Don't scare them, folks. Don't scare them. They're coming up for the popcorn, and that's a little too close. Good night, skunks. Don't spray. Please don't spray. And good night to you, folks. I'll sing you a hymn. Jesus calls us o'er the tumult of life's wild and restless sea. Day by day his sweet voice soundeth, saying, Christian, follow me. You know, we got to stop this because it's costing too much money, and it takes too much time, and it takes too much life. And so we're just going to go on to Internet, I guess, cut out this mailing, and just pray for these people. Pray for Charles Dolan. Pray for Cablevision Systems Corporation. Pray for all those people who take money to break the law. They break the law and they take money. They get paid for doing it. That's their job, to break the law and violate people's rights. Let's pray for them so they'll be happy and whole and healthy. We pray for all those people. Okie doke. Good night now. I was almost in bed, folks, and then I had to show you the moon. Oh, boy. We've said it so many times. God didn't have to give us a moon.